Hey, Neil Ratner, Ratdak here with a story. Okay, so September 8th, 1973, the great Marvin Gaye had the number one song in the United States with Let's Get It On from his album of the same name. And today, I thought I would tell you a little about Marvin and the tune that you might not know. But as usual, a little background first. Yeah, okay, so Marvin's rise to the top was a bumpy ride at best. His first number one song, I heard it through the grapevine, although a big success, left Marvin feeling unsatisfied. And he's, as he put it, he felt like Berry Gordy's puppet. And to make matters worse, his duet partner, Tammy Terrell, died unexpectedly from a brain tumor. So Marvin went into a deep funk and became totally disillusioned with the music business. And believe it or not, he even sought out a position with the Detroit Lions football team. He had become friendly with a couple of the players. They were going to give him a tryout, but then they decided not to because they didn't want him to get injured because they really wanted him to continue his music career. But as far as Marvin was concerned, man, he would have become a football player. All right. In June of 1970, though, he finally returned to Motown to record a new song called What's Going On. And the song was inspired by an idea from Rinaldo Opie Benson of the Four Tops. They were friends. And Benson had told him the story about this terrible act of brutality, police brutality, he had witnessed at an anti-war rally in Berkeley, California. And Marvin got very upset, decided to write a song about it. Okay. When he brought the tune to Berry Gordy, Gordy refused to release it. Berry felt the song was too political for radio. Gaye responded by saying, okay, you're not going to release the song? I'm going on strike. From recording until the label releases the song. And in 1971, Gordy finally relented, and you know what happened. The song reached number one on the R&B charts within a month, and then in 73, of course, it went on to be number one. It was a big, big tune for him. Stayed on the charts for a long time. And Marvin then gave Gordy an ultimatum. Marvin wanted full control over his next album. And, you know, because of the great success of What's Going On, he had no choice but to give in. Okay, so Gaye spent 10 days recording the album What's Going On that March, and it became Gaye's first million-selling album. And the success of the album got Gaye a new deal with Motown worth $1 million, making it the most lucrative deal by a black recording artist at the time. That million then would have been worth multiple millions now, so you can imagine. Okay, he followed with a soundtrack album, and then it was time for Marvin to come up with some new material. But he developed a serious case of writer's block, as writers often do. Let's go back a little bit. Now, during his childhood, Gaye had been physically abused by his preacher father, Marvin Gaye Sr., who disciplined his son under extremely moralistic and fundamentalist Christian teachings. And as a result, the meaning and practice of sex had become a disturbing question for Marvin Gaye, and it haunted him in his dreams. You know, now eventually he learned to cope with his personal issues with a newfound spirituality, and he began incorporating his new outlook into his music, as initially expressed in the socially conscious album, What's Going On. Now, in his next album, Let's Get It On, Gaye wanted to continue to have a deeper meaning in his music, and now focused on love and romance. But for Marvin, it was a metaphor for God's love, rather than the more obvious interpretation. Now, the song Let's Get It On was written by Ed Townsend and was about his desire to get on with life after he had beat alcoholism. But Marvin worked with Ed to make it a song dedicated to love and sex. Gaye was also motivated at the time by his infatuation with his friend, jazz guitarist Slim Gaillard's daughter, Janice, who Marvin would eventually marry and have children with. And according to legend, Janice was in the studio when Marvin recorded his vocal. And you can't imagine how that added to the passion and the way that he sung it and the way that we all hear it. Okay, now the song became the biggest selling Motown release in the United States at the time, selling over 2 million copies within the first 6 weeks, and it took Marvin's popularity to new heights. Unfortunately, Marvin's story has a sad ending. Marvin tried to break up a fight between his mother and his father. Afterward, he went back to his bedroom. But his father followed, had a gun in his hand, and shot Marvin dead at point-blank range. Initially charged with first-degree murder, Gaye Sr. was found to have a brain tumor and got a 6-year suspended sentence for involuntary manslaughter and died in a nursing home some years later. Marvin was only 44. Who knows what he would have come up with had he been alive today. Hey, that's life. Stuff happens. At any rate, we have his good music to listen to, Marvin Gaye. All right, that's my story for today. Join me for my post this week and on Radio Woodstock at 3 o'clock on Saturday and Sunday. Today, I got a cool story about Roger Waters, and Radio Woodstock's also on iHeartRadio. And probably in about 3 weeks, the Rock Doc podcast will start. Music is medicine. It will be available through Radio Woodstock's website. It'll also be available on iTunes and iHeartRadio and Spotify and Google Play. And I'll give you more information as we get closer. That's it for today. Have a good weekend. Enjoy the fall weather that's coming in if you're in a place where fall weather is coming. And I'll see you real soon. All right. Bye for now.